I'm going to be talking, particularly tomorrow, about Pew Research Center. If you're not familiar with Pew Research Center, I would encourage you to get familiar with it if you're interested in the kind of things we're talking about. All kinds of stuff comes up out of Pew Research. This came today. Dr. David Worley, whom some of you know in Austin, sent this to me. The most and least racially diverse religious groups in the U.S. Drum roll. some of you, hold your breath. There are, I'm guessing, 30 religious groups. The most racially diverse in the U.S., Seventh-day Adventist. Followed, now, this is not just Christian groups, this is everybody. Followed by Muslims, most racially diverse group in the U.S. Followed by Jehovah's Witness. Followed by Buddhist. Followed by, I love this category, nothing in particular. That ought to get everybody. Followed by the Catholics. Followed by Assemblies of God, followed by Church of God, Cleveland, Tennessee, which is the Pentecostal group, followed by Churches of Christ. And we beat out the American Baptists and the Atheists and the Agnostics and the Presbyterians. So it's going to be a good weekend, I can tell right now. I'll put this over here, but if you're interested in that sort of thing, they have one on religion and politics, which is one of my favorite places to go for good material. We'll start, we're going to have dinner at 5:30, is that correct, Jim? 5:30, two doors down here, and so we're going to do a leap here to get about 30 good minutes in to close to 5 o'clock, take a little break. We have, I think fajitas, right? And we have some classy entertainment. That's, you just won't believe the entertainment we have for you tonight, so I'm sure you won't want to miss that. That's all I'm saying. Okay, lesson three. This is a big one, and so we'll get a little bit of a head start. How do you like that task statement at the top? To carry the gospel message and interpretation of God's word throughout the world without, at the same time, carrying consciously or unconsciously our cultural bias with it. Very hard to do. Very hard to do. The worst condition is denial that you have cultural bias. So we'll start at the bottom and work up. Yes, sir.
I was going to say, how does our tradition fit into that cultural bias? I mean,
okay.
I didn't grow up in the church, and I was basically converted by tradition. Yep.
Okay. All right. I think you're not only your own tradition, whatever it was growing up, but your version of the tradition or where you lived matters. With Church of Christ, whether you lived east of the Mississippi or west of the Mississippi, there's probably some nuances there. This was back in the 50s or 60s. I was a young man at the time. Never could figure out why it was okay to have instruments at your wedding east of Mississippi more often than it was west, or is it the opposite way around? I can't remember. But the whole point is you have different nuances. And so geographically, I've always thought that your theology of thank you, my dear, finally some real coffee. I believe in stimulants. Where was I? We were talking about nuances and all that, but I was getting ready to say something profound.
Theology is something is determined by Greek or Jewish.
Oh, yeah. Theology of males and females swimming together. Historically called mixed bathing, which conjures up all kinds of weird things in my mind. That's why I didn't say the word. I think it's in proximity to large bodies of water. We're going to talk a little bit later about mores. M-O-R-E-S. Those of you who've been in the course before know this. Mores are often identified beginning with the phrase, you know, it goes without saying, boys and girls shouldn't swim together. It goes without saying, dancing is sinful. It goes without saying, card playing is sinful. My dad, I appreciate, him for so many things. Pam knows I nearly idolized him, but I appreciated his making a cultural leap of gigantic proportions when, as a teenager, he agreed to go to a bowling alley with me. Because he said all the time growing up, bowling alleys were associated with bars. They were in bars. And he said, this is the first bowling alley I've ever been in. So, anyhow. Yes? Yeah.
And one Sunday, Dr. McDonald, who was a member of the church there, came to the elders and said, I am treating three people in this congregation for tuberculosis, and unless this changes this week, I will report you to the health department. And it was amazing how their theology about it.
That's right. Tuberculosis will turn your theology. That's right. Now, I was going to say, mores have a funny way of turning into doctrine. And it's almost unconscious. That's the scary part. I mean, I'm sitting around wondering, what are my grandkids going to get up and ridicule me for because of some crazy thing that I was doing now? But let's keep going. Chapter 3. You're saying, what in the world is all this? All these stats have to do with Bible interpretation. Hang on, because they do. Look at this. Between 1900 and 2000, the number of Christians in Africa, I'm talking about, when I say Christians here, I'm talking about all general kinds grouped together, okay? Number of Christians in Africa grew from 10 million to more than 360 million, and by the way, it is still growing. And somebody called my hand on this, so I went and checked. I said there were more members of Churches of Christ on the continent of Africa than on the continent of North America, and I can't prove that statistically, but three missions experts have verified that the population of Churches of Christ in Africa are approaching 2 million members now, and the population in North America is shrinking toward 2 million. So within probably 5 to 10 years, African churches, church people affiliated with Churches of Christ will outnumber those in North America. I never thought in my lifetime I'd ever see anything like that. One of the big surprises of growing old. There's a bunch of them. Two-thirds of Roman Catholics live in the global south. Let's look at our map here. I'm talking about the global north and the global south. The nearest I can tell, this is a term that came out of the Cold War period, 1950s. And it is a lot more socioeconomic and political than it is geographical. And there are exceptions. I can look and find some exceptions, and no doubt you can. But the gyrations there in the shaded purple area give you a general impression of what, when I refer to the global south, that's what I'm talking about. All of Latin America, the difference, I'm doing some basic geography here for my own review as much as anything. Latin America includes South America and Central America. For instance, if this were accurate, it would loop up on the East Coast and pick up Haiti. Generally, that is the case. Now, some sobering things, we'll then move on. This is hard to believe, but 95% of the North has sufficient food and shelter. 95% of the North has functioning educational system. In the South, 5% of the population has ample food and shelter, not enough technology, very little stability, not a lot of economic activity going. Economic terms, the northern global north has 1/4 of the world's population. And the global north controls 4/5 of the world's income. And 90% of the manufacturing industries are in the global north. In the global south, 3/4 of the world's population, less than 1/5 of the world's income. Anyhow, that's a kind of a moving target, but that gives you some general figures. And here it is. There's a lot of interesting conclusions here. Let me let you tell me instead of me telling you. Just what I've told you, what you see here, what are some conclusions or observations? Okay, Christianity, Randy says Christianity historically has worked best in the counterculture. That's where I got started. Okay. Okay. All right. Yeah, Nigeria is an interesting place. We'll come back and talk about Nigeria a little bit later. Johnny?
Prosperity influences
okay.
The need of God.
Okay, you can make, we'll just lay it out there and let you wrestle with that. Prosperity, it seems, does not pull people toward God. Let's put it that way. And another way to say kind of the same thing is, Christianity is on the move and growing in more economically challenged areas. Let's look down the list here, and you're probably ahead of me anyway here. On number two there, 2/3 of the Catholics live in the global south, rising rapidly. I wrote this, and you might write this. Pope Francis may be the first Latino pope, but he will not be the last. That was a big step in our lifetime for a non-European or a pope, but that's big. And here, that's a partial answer to it, because the College of Cardinals will increase exponentially in Africa and Latin America. Catholic Church is shrinking in Europe, as is all Christian churches that I'm aware of. Africans and Asians represent some 30% of all Christians. And this kind of sobering, by 2025, 10 short years from now, our prediction is Africa and Latin America will vie for the title of the most Christian continent. We're not even in the running anymore. We're headed in the wrong direction. And number five blows my mind. I don't know what to do with that. Half of the world's population is under the age of 24. Isn't that staggering? Almost 90% of them live in the global south. I don't say this anywhere, but just another thing that's interesting, and that is the more advanced the economy becomes and the civilization becomes, the lower the birth rate. And so we have some European countries now are in a negative birth rate. Japan is also. In the Middle East parts of Asia, India, right in there. Something about 4.5 children per family, something like that. And most of that would be in what we would know as Islamic world. Mandarin Chinese, this one needs explaining. Mandarin Chinese is the most frequently spoken language in the world. That's probably not a surprise. Of the top five, followed English, Spanish, and Arabic. That's at least four. Okay, circle Spanish, and according to Philip Jenkins, who knows all and sees all, written two of these books over here, who, by the way, is now a professor at Baylor. If you ever have a chance to hear Philip Jenkins, go hear him. He's been here twice at ACU. Great scholar, probably one of the greatest scholars around on global Christianity and the trends of global Christianity. He can just spellbind me. He's an English gentleman and a prolific writer. According to Jenkins, the most populous church language is Spanish. More people speak Spanish in a Christian community globally than any other language. Does that make sense? The ACU group went to Avila, Spain, with our study abroad group. Went on a tour of Spain. Actually, we home-based in Oxford, but our one-week tour was Spain. Fantastic tour. I don't know if you've ever heard of Teresa of Avila. That's their kind of their hometown patron saint there. And we were there on St. Teresa's Day, and big celebration in this little town of about 12,000-15,000 people. But we were getting a tour of the cathedral, and the priest asked the group, "How many speak Spanish in this student group?" No hands went up. We got a lecture. "Don't you know that 500 million Christians in the world speak Spanish? Not a one of you can speak it." He's about this tall. I was at the back of back of the group and cowering at the time. Page two. By 2050, the growth of Christianity is expected to reach 3 billion, of whom only around one-fifth or fewer will be non-Hispanic whites, Caucasians. Very interesting. Somewhere on here, and we'll run into it, but I'm going to go ahead and say it now, probably by 2050, the most Christian nation in the world will be China. Isn't that interesting? Pam and I went to China twice. And I'm not going to do name dropping, but you would know who I went with if I named him. Several of us went to try to meet with some Chinese leaders and just say, you have nothing to fear from Christians. They're gentle people. They're not trying to take over the government. They're good citizens. And very interesting, the reception we got. When we got back, the missions faculty here wanted to meet with Pam and me and get our impression of what was going on in China. And I'm going to let you say it, Pam. What did you tell them? Remember? I'll repeat it here in a minute. Yeah. Pam says to our missions faculty, with me sitting there, president of the university, you guys would do better, do us all a favor if you stayed out of China. Now, why would we say something as outrageous as that? Because, okay, this was interesting. One of the pastors of a cell church of about 50 Chinese was an underground church. He went on the bus tour with us to the Great Wall of China, and so he was in secure surroundings. And so Pam and I were toward the front of the bus, and he was very excited to be with us and enjoy Christian fellowship, even though we spoke different languages. So through interpreter, he said to me, I want to show you some pictures of recent conversions. I don't know where this guy's coming from. And I thought to myself, this will really be interesting. What in the world are those pictures going to show? You pulled out a little photo album, you know, where you about 10 or 15, you can flip like this. Every picture was a baptism. And so I asked my Church of Christ friends when I get back, what were these people when they came up out of the water? They were members of the one universal body of Christ. Never heard of us, but they were members of the one universal body of Christ. And you have that happening all over China. You also have a lot of confusion. Don't get me wrong. You have a lot of theological confusion. They don't have schools that really can teach them. They can't be quite that open. And so there's a lot of confusion going on, but there's a lot of good stuff going on too. And so they'll very quickly outstrip North America in the number of believers. All right. Number 10, 1950, is the Seventh-day Adventist Church, which we just saw here as of today, is the most diverse church in North America. Had 1 million members, mainly in the U.S. Today they have 14 million, with only one of those being here. And so that says, well, you know, they're diverse, and then you figure in immigration and all this kind of stuff, and that probably gives you a hint as to why they came out number one. Between 1990 and 1970, the Christian population of Nigeria, we were talking about Nigeria a while ago, went from 1% to more than 44%, all kind of Christians now, with the overwhelming majority of them coming out of animism. What is animism? Well, simply put, it's a belief that everything has a soul. At least every living thing has a soul of some kind. And there's also a strong connotation of at least ancestor consciousness, if not ancestor worship. And so how in the world do you reconcile that with the Christian faith? I had a graduate student in my class from Ghana, West Africa, my graduate church history class year before last. We got into Christianity in Africa. And that's another thing you have to do. When I was going through studying church history, you study Europe, Martin Luther. Not much happened for Martin Luther, you know. And then through Western Europe, North America. What do you do now? When you study church history, you study history of Christianity in China, history of Christianity in Russia, in Africa. We talk about Africa, it's what, 54 nations. History of Christianity in South America, most of which we don't know much about. So I asked this guy from Ghana, he's a Church of Christ preacher in Ghana. Do you deal much with the spirit world in your church in Ghana? You know what he said? Every day. I know another guy who attended a church in Africa, and he was supposed to preach, and the head guy said, before Brother so-and-so gets up and preaches, we're going to have an exorcism. How would you like that one put on you? And so we Westerners would tend to say, well, I don't know. They've kind of taken this and run too far with it. But you see, these people live in the world of first century Christianity. Every day. We're the odd ones out. We've rationalized it. We've scientificized it out of our theology. And so, I don't know. When you think of exorcism, you think of the movie. I think I've met a few people in my ministry who will remain nameless that I think were demon-possessed. I could not explain it any other way. And I'm not an exorcist, so I didn't do anything, so in case you're wondering. But perhaps we've gone too far the other way and say, well, there's none of that. And when the New Testament says, really all the activity, most of the activity is in the spirit world. And by the way, it's where you came from, and by the way, it's where you're going back. This is the part that's not really real. Humanity. It's the other part that really lasts. So, all right, getting too quiet in here. I got to get on. Pentecostalism, that'll get us going. Number 12. You're not going to like this, but Pentecostalism and related charismatic movements are one of the fastest growing segments of global Christianity. Let me get some definitions here. Pentecostalism, the Pentecostalism is a family of churches, Pentecostal churches. You can be a charismatic and be a Methodist. A charismatic and believe in speaking in tongues, the full measure of the Spirit, and be in the Church of Christ, or be a Catholic, or a Baptist, or whatever. There's a whole family of Pentecostal churches. The biggest one in the U.S. is Assemblies of God. We live where the international headquarters were in Springfield, Missouri. So, look what Dr. Ferguson said. Probably the most significant event in 20th century Christian history. Started in 1906 in Los Angeles, California, on Azusa Street. Now that's as far, I forgot to get the number of the house. I think this coffee's kicking in, Pam. Look at this. This is just startling to me. At least a quarter of the world's 2 billion Christians are thought to be members of these lively, highly personal faiths, emphasize spiritual renewing gifts of the Spirit. In fact, you want to write in the margin, renewalists. Sometimes these people are called renewalists because they believe in the renewal of the Spirit. They believe in the full manifestation of the spiritual gifts as described in 1 Corinthians, to be exact. Now, when I was growing up, we make fun of these people. When I was a teenager in Temple, Texas, that's what we'd do for sport sometime. Sit outside their tent revivals and mock them. Very interesting movement. Poised to have, here's a red star. In fact, I've got red stars all over this number 12. This is basically the future of the growth of Christianity, or at least much of it, in the 21st century. The Global South, go back to your map, purple map there to page one. That's where it's most influential. And notice what it's doing, reshaping social, political, and economic landscape of many countries, Latin America, Africa, Asia. This is according to Pew Research. Look at this Jesus film. That's not Pentecostal, by the way, but just look at the distribution of it. It's amazing. And number 14 may surprise you. Despite all our efforts, still some 3,000 languages, many of them oral traditions, oral languages, and dialects that do not have the Bible translated in their own tongue. I'm a member of a board of a little bitty school in South Dallas. You may never heard of it. Graduate Institute for Applied Linguistics, GIAL. And their mission is basically to train Bible translators. They have about a couple hundred graduate students. And they teach cultural adaptation that we're talking about here. And a really interesting group. They are outgrowth of the Wycliffe Bible translators. Let's finish this afternoon with a rousing story of some of the pitfalls that come in Bible translation. Now, if you're in Asia somewhere, Southeast Asia perhaps, Laos, I'm on page 6 now of that lesson, and you're up trying to read the 23rd Psalm, which we're all very familiar with, right? And here was the literal translation into this oral language. I'll read it, and then we'll go to dinner. I think you can follow along. The great boss is the one who takes care of my sheep. I don't want to own anything. I shall not be in want. You see that? Lord, my shepherd, I shall not want. I don't want to own anything. The great boss wants me to lie down in the field. He wants me to go to the lake. He makes my good spirit come back. Even though I walk through something the missionary calls the valley of the shadow of death, I do not care. You are with me. You use a stick and a club, rod, staff, to make me comfortable. Here's the funny one. You manufacture a piece of furniture right in front of my eyes while my enemies watch. You prepare a table before my enemies, in the presence of my enemies. You pour car grease on my head. My cup has too much water in it, therefore overflows. Goodness and kindness will walk single file, that's important, single file behind me all my life. I will live in the hut of the great boss until I die and am forgotten by the tribe. Now, poor old missionary beginning missionary thought he was reciting the 23rd Psalm, and that's how it came out. And you can see on the second page there, which would be your page 7, some implications. I didn't know about this ministry until I found this story, T4 Global. But they specialize in helping tribes with oral traditions. A lot of these translators that GIAL trains have to go in, and they go into tribes where there has never been a language written down. And they have to learn, and this is just mind-blowing to me, they have to learn what the words mean and then figure out a word for that symbol. And that's where they have to start. They don't start, okay, this is what your language says, we translate it here. They go back. It's just amazing to me how many oral tribes there still are. I have with me today Dr. Rodney Ashlock. Rodney, in addition to being an Old Testament scholar, we share an alma mater, Baylor. So,
yes, sir.
Go Bears.
Sickle Bears.
And go Wildcats.
Go Wildcats, too, yes.
I'd like to talk with you about the Hebrew language and how it's used in the Old Testament scriptures, how it's translated. So let's talk first of all about the Hebrew language. What kind of a language is it, and what challenges does it present to translators?
Sure. Hebrew is a Semitic language, which means that it is a little bit further east than maybe we're accustomed to. The little quirk, it goes from right to left, but it has shares a lot of affinities with the language that comes from the modern-day Iraq, Akkadian, maybe some of you have heard of that, Ugaritic, to the north there. So there's affinities with Hebrew and the local nations, which gives rise to a lot of interesting possibilities with regard to translations. Where do words come from? The word for God is used in both Canaanite literature as well as Israelite literature as well, that we find in the Old Testament or Hebrew Bible. So that little, those two little letters at the end of Israel, E-L, is the word for God. But it also is used in Canaanite literature and stories.
So it's not exclusive to the Hebrew
religion? Not exclusive.
Religion.
Not at all.
Okay.
So that's one of the things you have to think about, is that there are relationships between these little bitty nation states, like Israel, like Canaan, like the Moabites and the Ammonites. So those languages have a lot of common features. So if you learn Hebrew, in a sense, you're learning quite a bit about Ammonite and Moabite and Edomite languages as well. So these neighbors are very, very close to each other, and so they share a lot of similarities.
So they could probably understand each other more than we would with some totally.
They sure could. And so we have things that we overlap with regard to findings and ancient pieces here, that if you know a little bit about ancient Hebrew script, then you can translate into an Edomite stone or a Moabite piece of literature as well.
What challenges does this present to translators as they go from Hebrew all the way to contemporary English?
Sure. With Greek, you have a lot of cognates. In other words, you can see where this English word comes from by looking at the Greek.
Right.
With Hebrew, not so much. There are very, very few cognates. So Hebrew is indeed a very foreign language to us. It goes right to left. The characters do not look, it looks more like chicken scratch to us. So it's hard to make out things initially. In other ways, it's a little bit simpler. Many things about grammar and the way that they structure sentences could be a little bit easier to translate. However, there aren't as many Hebrew words, and so that leads to some ambiguity with regard to how you translate a particular word. It could mean two or three things. Another feature about the Hebrew languages, they typically derive from three-letter verbal roots. So when you only have three letters, those combinations are going to start to repeat themselves a little bit. So do we have a word that means this, or does it mean that? So context becomes very, very important. You know, there's a rule, context, context, context. Mm-hmm. When you're interpreting or translating Hebrew into English, you have to keep that in mind, which is also another good cue for us to read more than one version, more than one translation, to keep two or three Bibles at hand, and so we can compare between the two and see which one maybe reflects the context the best, or if we can't determine that, at least know what the variables are and what the different possibilities are with regard to our translations and interpretations.
You know, in the modern English translations, the translators, particularly the group translators, which we highly recommend, are pretty good at putting notes at the bottom.
Sure,
notes at the bottom that it could be this, it could be that, but that what you're saying explains why you have so many of those throughout the Old Testament. Where you don't have it seems to me such a contrast to Greek, which is so exact. I mean, you can do things with Greek tenses, even meanings, agape, love, you know, love having three, four different meanings as an example in Greek.
Sure.
But in Hebrew, what you're saying is you don't have that exactness. And
no, not at all.
That's all right.
And one, I guess, fairly well-known incident is the word for thousands, or what we get when you talk about the book of Exodus and how many Israelites were coming out of Egypt, right. And we get this very, very large number. Mm-hmm. That same word could mean clan. So instead of saying 600,000, it might be saying 600 clans.
Large families.
Yes, large families there. So that would change the dynamic of the Exodus group immediately.
Yeah.
But it's hard to know. Just looking at the word itself, does it mean thousands or does it mean clan or some other possibility as well? Another great case is the very first word of the Old Testament, which could be translated in the beginning or when God began, which does give a little bit of a different nuance to what you're looking for. So if you read different translations, you might come across the more traditional in the beginning. But you might also find when God began, which shifts what we may think about the origins or the beginnings of the Bible, but also the creative process.
You've given us a great example and a great insight into reading the Old Testament. Now, as an English reader, let's conclude here with just a few remarks about what all of this means to a reader of English who does not know Hebrew. What is your best advice, in addition to just looking at multiple translations, is it good advice to kind of back off our Western American exactness mode here and get more into the mood of what's happening, or what do we do?
Yes, I have a good tip, and this is actually kind of fun. Use your imagination a bit.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's one of the things. When you start looking at multiple translations, you begin to realize, wait a minute, this could go this way or that. Well, imagine both possibilities or all three possibilities. Be creative. I mean, Genesis 1 gives us a little bit of a license to be creative. And it doesn't mean irresponsible, but it does mean that you can be a little bit creative when it comes to understanding. Be willing to have your understanding of the Old Testament expand a little bit. Don't assume that there's only one meaning here and I have to grasp the one correct, right meaning. Be open to possibilities of different, multiple meanings here that might actually enhance your overall understanding of what's taking place in a book like Genesis or Ecclesiastes, wherever you happen to be studying. So that's one thing. I think second, since it is in Hebrew, we might want to think about, even as Christians, reading some of our books, some of our commentaries, some of our study helps from Jewish authors. Even if there are some differences
right.
in our theological perspective and understanding
right.
of Messiah, nevertheless, this is their native language.
Yeah.
And there are some great Jewish scholars who have written tremendous books that might help you understand what on earth is going on in Leviticus.
Mm-hmm.
There's a 2,700-page commentary written by a Jewish scholar who will go through all the technical, that's more than you want. But I mean, that's an idea that they can be helpful to us in understanding this bizarre world of the ancient Near East, which is not familiar to us. It's
right.
not close at hand. There could be some helps out there that we might have to look a little bit further to find,
yeah.
but they're there. And they can really provide insight into our reading.
Well, you've given us some great insights. Thank you, Ron.
You're welcome.
Well, did Rodney mess with your mind a little bit? Hebrew is different. It's different. I didn't make too good a grade in Hebrew. And Tony Ash and I have had a talk about that. And he said, if I'd known you were going to be president, I wouldn't have given you a C. But I said, no, on the contrary, I earned the C. And so, and then there was Pam. We've been married how many months? Six? And I was taking Hebrew in summertime, 8 lessons a day. Also taking world religions, which is messing with my mind. Also working full-time for Dean Garvin Beecham, whom I will quote here in just a little bit. And it ate my lunch. And so Pam and I had this talk as newlyweds. And as best I recall, Pam, it was something, it kind of boiled down to you saying, it's either me or Hebrew, you decide, or something like that. Anyhow. And I've never regretted that decision. So I dropped second semester Hebrew. All right. We're on page 3, Dr. Strader, of chapter 3, lesson 3. Dr. Strader needs special guidance. I've got Pam on his right hand and Mrs. Strader on the left hand, so you can keep up that way. I may have better attention now because I was trying to cheat during the video and get online, and I couldn't because it must be raining outside or something, or the birds on the wire or something. Anyhow, is it raining outside? Yeah. Did it rain outside or not? Jim is also chief meteorologist. All right. Yeah, we never complain about the rain in Abilene, Texas. I remember that. Okay. You're getting the idea about the East and West contrast. I'll just kind of skip down on page 3, number 4, we've kind of already hit that. Did I cover 1, 2, and 3, or did I not? Okay. You're right, Dr. Strader. I don't know what I'm doing. That is correct. All right, we left off at the following observations and conclusions, right? Okay. We'll zip through these because some of them are review. So very cross-cultural, number one. Number two, it has to be contextual. You heard that from Rodney. You've heard that from Randy. Everybody, when, where, don't unconsciously assume anything. Okay, Rodney caused me some extra work by saying just use your imagination. I think what he's saying is this is a, whether you like it or not, a Semitic language. It is an ancient Semitic language. And it doesn't even have vowels, really. There's not really anything like it that I can point to today to where you can just whip it off, you can just read it off, because as Rodney is saying, the word can mean this one time, it can mean this next time, it can mean this. That's why these translators in the Old Testament particularly, you go to the bottom, to the margins down there, and they'll say it could be this or it could be that. Because some places the text is questionable. There's no way to judge the context, and that just runs us Westerners nuts. Good Church Christ girl, especially nuts. Yeah. And then this, rank heresy that he talks about, where the word thousands mean clan or tribe. It's the same word, and so you have to figure out. Of course, a clan can be several hundred people. Because it's everybody, it's grandma and grandpa, and all the family, all the servants, and all the livestock, and everything else thrown in. So it's just that inexact. Now, what I'm challenging you to do is don't make too much of that, but don't make too little of it either. It is what it is. I didn't invent Hebrew. Lord knows that. So I think basically the lesson here is when he says use your imagination, don't apply to the Old Testament text the type of almost a slavish type of exactness that we love to have in the wordsmithing in our English language. It's just not there. It's a different kind of cat. It's a different breed. And therefore, you have to have some flexibility because it can mean one thing here, it can mean one thing there. And for instance, you have a little of that in Greek, although Greek is far more exacting than Hebrew. But in Greek, the word for woman and the word for wife, as I may have mentioned, is the same. And so you have to depend on the context. But whether you're talking about women in 1 Timothy 3 or deacons' wives, in some congregations makes a difference. You're talking about deaconesses or you're talking about wives of deacons. So anyhow, as far as I'm going in that mud puddle. So it is, if it's a bit confusing, that's okay. But I'm simply asking you to have respect for the Hebrew language and have a lot of love. What's that? Oh, yes, Chip, I'm sorry. Yeah.
On that point, I know Rodney didn't talk about it if you had enough time. That it's extremely helpful in the people that did this a couple of centuries before Jesus was born.
Yeah.
Were extremely helpful. Jewish experts translating mm-hmm. the Hebrew Old Testament into Greek.
Yeah.
Is a tremendous starting point for helping resolve some of these.
Yeah.
You didn't get much more expert than they did at the time. So we're not just guessing in the wild.
No, that's true.
Not
what Rodney meant. No, but he did not mean that. What Chip is talking about is the Septuagint. And the Septuagint is basically a translation of the Hebrew into the Greek, which then is used by translation scholars as a part of the fabric of translating into English. Now, to show you the difference, among the oldest Hebrew manuscripts we have in the Old Testament is around the time of Jesus. I'm being really general here and generous. Around the time of Jesus. So, you got quite a time gap between when it happened and when we begin to have written records of it. And so, when you look at the New Testament, by the time Revelation is written, which I think is in early 90s or maybe 95 AD, well, I've already told you the earliest fragment in New Testament Greek is 120. I mean, it's within 25 years of when some of it was first written, or 30 or 40 years. That's why the Dead Sea Scrolls, you may have heard about them, are so important in the discovery, because they contain some of the most ancient Hebrew manuscripts that we have. Pam and I were privileged to see one of the Dead Sea Scrolls that a Jewish antiquities merchant had stashed up in his attic. The only reason they survived is they were put in these clay pots and sealed, and they were in the middle of the desert with very low humidity. It's the only reason they survived. It's the only reason they're not a pile of dust. Very, very rare breakthrough. The neat thing is you have very little variance, and that's kind of what you're making reference to, very little variance in the text. And so that is, to me, very comforting. But the Septuagint was a major breakthrough, late 2nd, early 3rd century AD. And so it was, when we talk about the scriptures that the Christians used in the first century, I trust we all understand it was the Old Testament. Until the writings of Paul begin to be referred to toward the end of the first century as scripture, and also the Gospels a little bit later. And then you have all of these church councils and meetings, and finally, around 325 or 30, somewhere in there, you begin to have what we now know as the books of the Bible. fascinating story. That's a course all in and of itself. Okay, Eastern and Western view, number three, we're gonna kick that around one way and then the other, but here's a little bit of a comparison. In the East, Eastern Hemisphere relationships, Trump rules. In the West, rules over relationships. Now I'm making gross generalizations, so stay with me. In the East, collectivist viewpoint. The big deal is the community, the family. The West, individual. In the West, things tend to be right or wrong, white or black, either or. In the East, decisions are more complicated. And I'll talk about that just a little more in a minute. And then you have concepts of honor and shame and saving face. Boy, that's important in Eastern ways of thinking. So we're profoundly influenced by our culture to recognize certain virtues and vices. Let me show you how this works. I don't know if everybody can see this or not. As long as I can see it, we're okay. Group of North American Christians were asked to rank some of the highest values that they thought highest, the most important values. And I'll read this for those of you who can't see it, and I'll leave it up here. The North Americans said, this group said, we'd probably put truthfulness first. The North American Christians said, truthfulness is really important. And then second to it, self-control. By the way, you can see biblical injunctions about all of these, can't you? The third one is efficiency. Okay, now, Kenyan Christians. Here's what they rank number one. Showing respect and honor. Number two, maintaining harmony in relationships. Big deal. Those of you who have done international business are probably tracking with me. Number three, helping the needy. See that communal sense? Guess what their lowest values were? Punctuality. If you've ever been in the East or in the Southern Hemisphere even, you know about that one. Punctuality, no big deal. Meet at 7:30, 8:15, whatever. Transparency, really important in a communal setting. And third, oh my goodness, honesty. That was number one in the West. Well, gets worse. Okay, before I do the punchline here, the Kenyans were asked to rate. Let's see, the Americans, North Americans, were asked to rate what they thought was the worst sin or two or three. And for those of you who can't see, adultery was number one. Number two, lying. And stuff like that. Here's the Kenyans. Number one, sin, selfishness, and individualism. Oh my, we're in trouble. Number two, greatest sin, embarrassment of others, causing them shame. It's a big deal in Eastern societies. Number three, losing one's temper or raising your voice. Oh my goodness, it gets worse, I tell you. At the bottom of their list was adultery. way down at the bottom. Christians. I'm not saying that makes it right or wrong. I'm simply saying, did you expect to spread like that? At the bottom of their list of the most sinful things was adultery. After all, people will be people. So, I just thought that was really interesting. Yes, Sarah? No, it's just, it is one of those deals to where if it does happen, it does not erase fidelity or monogamy. It simply means we got to do something to get this right. You cannot leave the community. You've got to get this right and stay in the community. What the Westerners tend to do in the church is throw the person out of the offender out of the community. Whereas the idea here is we got to come in. In fact, it's more of a biblical concept when you look at the New Testament. Somebody overtaken in a sin, you who are spiritual, do what? Kick him out? No, restore him in a spirit of gentleness, lest you too may be tempted. Oh my goodness, it sounds just like the Kenyans. Well, enough preaching. Let's sing "Just As I Am." Go home. I'm just kidding. I'm not quite sure. All right. I just think stuff like that, don't take it too literally. Just understand what a gap there is sometimes in our understanding. And here you are, some of you in here have done cross-cultural missions. And you're aware of all kinds of subtleties. I'm painting broad strokes here, so give me some leeway. Remember the story of the little red hen? She found some grain and said, when any goes around all the barnyard animals, would you help me plant? Would you help me do this? Would you help me water? Would you help me? No, we're too busy. No. And then when she baked the bread, they all wanted to come eat some. And so the moral to the story is, if you don't work, you don't eat. That sounded also like Paul, didn't it? In the West, we prioritize virtues and vices. You ask a lot of Westerners, rank the worst vices, and you'll come up with a list pretty similar to what we looked at. Number six, there's the mores again. Things that are accepted without question and embody the fundamental moral view of the group. And it's amazing to me how many of the mores we have are centered around sex, food, and money. Trends and emphases. Now, these are not neat patterns, so don't make too much of this, but don't make too little either. The difference. In the global south, now we're talking about Africa, we're talking about Latin America, generally speaking, they're much more theologically conservative than Europe and North America. Do you begin to see that? This will be a big thing, I think, in future decades. Regardless of what you think, whether you think this Pope is anti-capitalist and pro-socialist or not, set that aside temporarily and say, what does Pope Francis have a passion for? The poor, the dispossessed. And on theological matters, he's generally more conservative than a lot of the other College of Cardinals. Okay, view of biblical authority tends toward a high view of Scripture. What that means is take Scripture really seriously. It is, oftentimes they would refer to it as the inerrant Word of God, the sufficient guide in all matters. Notice this, we already said this, here's a red star. The Africans make no different distinction between the spiritual and the physical. Let that soak in a little bit. No difference between the world of the spirit and the physical world. With Asians, it's more complex, but there's a lot of activity going on in ancestry and that kind of thing. Decisive move in the global south toward literal and fundamentalist views is expected to continue. We talked about that in lesson two. The Anglican communion is interesting. If you want to write the word Episcopal out there, the Anglicans in the U.S. are called Episcopalians. The reason was, anybody know the reason? 1776 has something to do with it. They couldn't call themselves the Church of England very easily, since they were pulling away from England and the king was head of the church. So they have an Episcopal form of government, similar to the Catholic Church in that sense. And so they begin to be known as Episcopalians. Very interesting, in 2003, you remember this, most of you in the room, when Bishop Gene Robinson was elected Episcopal bishop in New Hampshire, first non-celibate homosexual bishop to be ordained. Philip Jenkins, in his book, makes a pretty big deal out of that. He said that was a watershed moment in the Anglican Communion, and what it did was divide the more liberally minded and the more conservative minded. And we saw this, those of you Abilenians, we saw this at the Church of the Heavenly Rest, Episcopal Church here. A sizable number left. Notice a quote of the Nigerian bishop. That's a typical quote, by the way. I didn't write the Bible. It's part of a Christian heritage. It tells us what to do. If the Word of God says homosexuality is an abomination, then so be it. Now, it's interesting because in the Episcopal form of government, if you're a thoroughgoing Episcopalian and you think your church has gone off and left you by supporting this gay bishop, you have to be under an episcopate. That's just kind of the way it is. And guess where many American Episcopal churches looked for conservative bishops? Africa. So you have all this weird sort of stuff that this church in Dallas, Texas is under the jurisdiction of an Anglican bishop in Ghana or somewhere. Very interesting. And this is all happening kind of right in front of us in the last 10 years. I've already cautioned you about media coverage and what kind of the terminology they throw around pretty loosely. Okay, page four, Dr. Strader, we're marching to the end. Yes, Don? Why is the Global South more fundamentalist or more conservative? I would use the word conservative as a broad net term. I think there are a combination of reasons. It's not simply one that you can point to. I think it's a combination of factors. There is a higher respect for the spiritual, for one thing, generally speaking. It's an easier jump than it is in modern scientific Western part of the world. So the spiritual is more real, and I think in the case of our fellowship, what happened was that you have a lot of the missionary expansion in the 50s and the 60s, and most of those were pretty conservative Church of Christ missionaries in our own fellowship. And therefore, some of that stuck. What is interesting is what's happening in, say, churches like Ghana, where there's a Christian college being established. This is the work that some of you trustees know. Dion Farrow, one of your former trustees, fellow trustees, he's very invested in that work, literally and figuratively. And that will introduce a new level of awareness of higher education. And a lot of these Ghanaian preachers, for instance, we provide scholarships for one or two of them to come at a time over to the U.S. to ACU to get a master's degree, and oftentimes they'll leave their wife and children child or two, usually young preachers. And that's how much they value graduate education. And I had a great breakthrough about, 5 or 6 months ago. We finally have approved by the Accrediting Association for ACU to offer complete master's degrees in Bible online. And so they don't have to make the trek anymore. Now, some of them still will choose to come because their reasoning is, when we are home, we are totally consumed by the work. And if we're going to get anything done, we're going to have to remove ourselves. So that's going to continue to be a problem. I don't know what we're going to do about that. But it's really interesting. I can't, beyond that, tell you why, except that the cultural is more receptive to a higher view of Scripture and more conservative view of the world. But it's pretty pervasive, and it's pretty obvious. Now, yeah.
Couldn't it be that maybe when you introduce something new, you do the basics? And if it's a new church or a new Christian, someplace else, they learn the basics.
Yeah, that's true. That when when you're in a relatively new geographical area, first 50 or 60 years, this is pretty well the pattern. That's true. What will be interesting is, that's why I was saying about this Christian college, and then you got African Christian College in Swaziland, and then you have Livingstone Christian University, which is in Rwanda. No, not in Rwanda, Uganda. And they form a triangle in Africa, and one of the things we're working on is providing ways for graduates, baccalaureate graduates in those three colleges to work on graduate degrees here. So it'll be interesting. Almost all the faculty, all the Bible faculty, I think it's 100% of the Bible faculty at Heritage Christian College in Accra have master's degrees from ACU. So it'll be interesting to see what happens in the future, but those tend to change, and we'll see if the whole culture changes or not. But I think when all the dust settles, my prediction would be it'll still be more conservative because the West is so far ahead of them in terms of secularization. Not anything really good, but we're ahead of them in a bad way. In that we, as a culture, increasingly devalue the spiritual dimension. I need to talk a little bit about the gospel of prosperity. It is problematic in the South. Don't know how much you know about that. I've given you a sampling here. This belief is not just in the over in Africa and Asia. It's also in Texas, shall we say. It's almost everywhere, and that is that God really wants you to be prosperous and happy, and it's not only a privilege, but it's a right and a duty if you're truly seeking the Lord, health and wealth and happiness. It's been around for quite a while. But look at this. This is just staggering, 12b. This is in Asia. Central Full Gospel Church, don't know whether you've heard of it or not. Look at their membership. 830,000 congregants. They have about 8 or 9 services a Sunday. Anybody been? Seoul, Korea. No. They believe that this is a promise of 3 John 2, verse 2. I won't be able to quote it directly, but John hopes that his readers will be blessed physically as much as they're blessed spiritually. And what I think John means is health-wise and all that. They take that to mean wealth-wise. And so that's where they're getting it. the literal interpretation of the Beatitudes. Moving over to Africa, David Oyedepo, I don't know if you ever heard of him or not, senior pastor of Faith Tabernacle in Nigeria, seats 50,000 people, presiding bishop of Living Faith Church. It's all over, even a few in the U.S., affectionately known as Papa. He and five other pastors each own private jets. I did notice that Reverend Creflo Dollar, out of Georgia, is that right? Finally gave up on his request for his congregants to give him $65 million to buy a private jet. So you can be relieved you won't be hit up for a pledge from Reverend Dollar, but that's in Georgia. That's not in Africa. So this has been around a long time, and of course they're tax exempt. Page 5, he's one of the pioneers of this Christian charismatic movement in Africa. And look at this, the world's wealthiest pastor. We haven't talked about the role of women, so it's late. Pam, get the car running. We're winding up right here. Pardon the pun, but it's all over the map, and so there's not a discernible pattern. Fairly conservative position. Again, you're talking about 50, 60, 70 different countries, so you can't make too many specific observations. More and more women are being ordained in leadership roles, and that varies. If you are in a Pentecostal fellowship, the chances are that you have an increased role of women. Because from day one, meaning 1906, Azusa Street, Los Angeles, California, from day one, men and women were equally accepted in leadership capacities. So I went to high school with a guy on the football team whose mother was a Pentecostal pastor. And so it's been that way from day one. It doesn't mean that if you have more freedom involving women that you're Pentecostal. Don't make that jump. I'm just saying, in Pentecostal traditions, it's been that way for about 100 years. Takeaways, really quick. Here's a red star. If you can catch the global view of Christianity, it will change the way you read the New Testament. I hope you can begin to see that now. We'll get more specific in the morning. And I hope this course, I don't hope it doesn't confuse you so too much, but I think you have to legitimately ask the question, whose interpretation is right, or how do I know mine is? Or is there more than one interpretation? I think there is enormous potential to shape global Christianity in the global South. They're receptive, they're growing by leaps and bounds. And if I were on a missions committee and wanted to go where the action is, I would go to the Global South. That's where Christianity is growing. This reminds me that when I was looking at that Global South and this sort of thing, there are obvious exceptions that map does not pick up, and Brazil is one, and there are several countries in South America. So I'm picking at my own map there, but there are obvious exceptions, but majority of South America is still in some type of developing mode. There was a question over here somewhere. Okay. Barry?
I had a comment or reaction to your statement. Yeah. You're on a missions committee. That would be where you target reflects a certain cultural bias that we are the ones who do missions.
Okay. There are now Korean missionaries in the U.S., and so you're exactly right. Thank you. You're getting it. That's great. When we go to China, you want to know the talk of the visionary Christians? they look at us and smile and say, one of these days, we'll be sending Christian missionaries to the United States. That kind of makes my skin crawl to even say that, but that's the reality. Thank you, Barry. That's the reality of it. And so you have east coming west and south coming north. And so it's a different ballgame. It's complex. That's all I'm saying in number four. And don't get the idea that culture is the enemy. The God who created us all created the cultures. And somehow through all of that expects us to have a spirit of unity. I have a little bitty red star by 5A1. Democracy and prosperity and emphasis on individual freedoms, which we see all around us, are ideal seedbeds for unconscious cultural bias in global evangelism and missions. And I just stepped into that one. That it's our job to send missionaries to other places. The enemy is unconscious cultural bias and how to interpret the deeper truths of Scripture. Tough stuff, tough stuff.